Hi everybody, Henry Ford is one of the greatest businessmen of the 20th century. And the most astonishing thing about him is that way back in 1900s itself, in spite of having just $28,000 in investment, he turned the Ford Motor Company into a billion-dollar company in just 22 years. And not just that, while every other company during that time was paying its workers just $2.5 a day, Henry Ford paid his workers $5 a day. And in spite of the double pay, while other car companies sold their cars at $700 price point, the Ford Model T was being sold at just $360. Yes, you heard that right. Henry Ford paid his workers 100% more and yet kept the cost of his car 50% lesser than the competition. And this golden equation turned Ford Motors into such a dominating force in the automobile industry that even today, the Ford Model T is one of the highest sold vehicles in world history with a sale of 16.5 million units. The question is, how did Henry Ford manage to achieve something so incredible? What exactly were his business strategies? And as future business leaders, what are the lessons that we need to apply to our business? This video is brought to you by Cuckoo FM, but more on this at the end of the video. This is a story that dates back to 1903 America, and during that time, cars were extremely costly, which is why only rich people could afford a car. It was almost like owning an Aston Martin in today's world. This was a time when even $500 a year was considered to be a handsome income. And at the same time, the base price of a car was $850. In fact, when Henry Ford introduced the Model T, even Model T had a base price of $825. And with such a small market, Ford had a lot of competition with the likes of Charmer, Cadillac, and 10 other companies fighting to capture the small market. This is when Henry Ford realized that if he keeps selling cars only to the rich, with the existing competition in play, he will never be able to scale up his company. So he decided to sell the car to the common man and started tapping onto the lower segments of the market. But the biggest challenge over here was that it was practically impossible to generate profits if the cars were sold at a price below $600. And yet, Henry Ford was such a genius that suddenly from 1910 onwards, year on year, the price of a Ford car started dropping drastically. And they started with $950 in 1910, and within 3 years, they were able to generate massive profits even by selling the car at $600. And not just that, by 1917, the price of Model T had fallen by 60% to just $360. As a result of which, the sales skyrocketed by 4,100%, making Ford not just the biggest but also the most profitable automobile manufacturer in the world. The question is, what exactly did Henry Ford do special because of which he was able to bring down the price of the car to $600, which was considered impossible during that time? The first part of this answer lies in this 200-year-old book called The Wealth of the Nations, written by a Scottish economist named Adam Smith. In this book, Adam explains a concept called the division of labor, wherein, when he visited a pin factory, he observed that making a pin typically requires 18 steps. And when 10 men are asked to make a pin from start to end by executing all the 18 steps, they produced 20 pins each, which amounts to 200 pins a day. But when the same process was modified such that each worker did only one or two tasks to collectively manufacture the pin, for example, the first guy only cut the metal, the second worker just straightened it, and the third guy just sharpened it. This way, the efficiency of the system shot up to such an extent that the same 10 men were able to produce 48,000 pins in a single day. That's 4,800 pins per worker and a 240 times increase in efficiency. This was the power of division of labor and the impact of channelizing the efforts of each worker into a specialized micro activity rather than a generalized procedure. And guess what? This is exactly what Henry Ford applied to his factory. Back in the day, manufacturers used to outsource the making of a part to highly skilled workshops, wherein extremely skilled workers used to craft every major part of the car and then it used to be assembled at the factory. But Henry Ford changed this completely. For example, instead of asking one craftsman to make one entire engine body, he divided the body into three parts and then he made separate machines for each part such that only one worker will be in charge of an entire machine. Secondly, even the microprocessors were curated using the division of labor. And as the journalist John Finch describes this protocol, he says, "One man fits the parts together so that the bolt holes come right. The next man fits the bolt holes into place. The next man has a pan of nuts before him, and all day he scoops them up and with his fingers puts them on the thread of the bolts. The next man has a wrench and he gives the final twist that makes them tight." And this way, the entire process of making the Model T was so extensively designed that the entire process was divided into 84 discrete steps. Therefore, instead of having a skilled worker do an entire work, the work was divided into micro procedures and was executed through division of labor. This way, the laborers did not move around and they did not switch between tasks and were completely focused on just one activity, making them super efficient workers. This was the first pillar that made Ford factories extremely efficient as compared to the competitors. On top of that, Henry Ford also collaborated with a leading time and motion study expert called Frederick Taylor. And he brought in some game-changing techniques using something called the principle of scientific management. The most famous example of Frederick Taylor was when he succeeded in actually moving the pig iron in the most efficient manner. The task was pretty simple. A worker had to take pig iron from the blast furnace and then carry it up a plank onto a railroad. This is when Taylor studied every move that the workers made as they conducted their daily activities. At that time, a good worker was able to move up to 12 tons per day. But based on his biomechanical analysis of energy, expenditure and efficiency, Taylor calculated that a man in good condition should be able to move up to 47 tons a day. Now he knew that simply by telling the workers to do a better job, they will not work better. In fact, even if they were willing to do it, they would just try to speed up things and then get tired, eventually end up not moving even 12 tons. Therefore, based on his biomechanical analysis, Taylor knew that the best way to achieve 47 tons would be to walk at a certain measured pace, to carry the materials in a particular way, drink water at measured intervals, and to take very frequent but short breaks, whether the man needed it or not. And he even put the men on a stopwatch and told them when to move and when to stop. And every little move that they made was orchestrated very, very carefully. And surprisingly, the very first day itself, the first subject was able to move 47 tons in a single day. But in return, he also offered them an incentive up to 60% increase in pay if the laborers followed all the procedures and achieved the necessary targets. So to put that straight, Ford Motors achieved an incentive of 60% increase in pay for a productivity increase of 300%. In fact, even Henry Ford introduced the 5-day workweek based on this concept such that while all other factories got workers to work for 7 days a week, Ford only asked its workers to work for 5 days a week such that the workers could rest well and then spend the money that they earned, which will motivate them further to work better. And the most astonishing thing he did was that he passed on the profits to both his employees and to his customers. And that is how, ladies and gentlemen, on 5th of January 1914, Henry Ford doubled the pay of his workers, paying them $5 per work day. Now this was so revolutionary that workers flooded from all across the world to work for Henry Ford. And the ones who got the job worked with absolute dedication, which further increased both efficiency and profits. And then came the most game-changing strategy that redefined the automobile industry forever. To tell you about it, during that time, the way factories made cars was that the body of the vehicle was stationed at one place and the workers used to move around and attach the parts or did their jobs on the body. And that is when Henry Ford visited the meat packaging plant in Chicago. Over there, he saw that a piece of meat was hanging from the ceiling and it was progressing through the plant to different workstations where the meat was being processed. He stood there watching the meat going from station to station and being processed by specifically trained workers who were doing only one particular task. So he thought even he could put together a car the exact same way that these guys were taking apart the meat. And that is how, ladies and gentlemen, the concept of assembly line was born, wherein instead of the workers moving around the car, the body of the car itself started moving around the factory, wherein as the body of the car started moving from station to station, one worker who did one job very well did his job, and then the car started moving to the next station. And even to this day, this concept is being used by billion-dollar companies all across the world. Therefore, when all these strategies were applied at the Ford plant, the productivity and profits of the company skyrocketed. Initially, the chassis was being assembled in 12 hours and 8 minutes. But by 1914, because of these efficient strategies, it took only 93 minutes for the Ford workers to assemble a completely new Model T. Meanwhile, because of the division of labor strategy, highly skilled workers could be substituted by unskilled workers very, very easily, which eventually saved up a ton of cost in wages. This led to extreme reduction in cost and at the same time, shot up the productivity of the plant by a large extent. So if you see, it's almost like a very powerful vicious cycle wherein high efficiency of the workers led to low cost, which led to high demand, which further led to more orders, leading to mass production that led to lower cost, which again led to more efficiency. This is the reason why the Ford Motor Company was able to sell the Model T at 50% less cost in spite of paying the workers 100% more wages. And eventually, this turned Ford Motor Company into a billion-dollar company back in the 1900s itself. And this brings me to the most important part of the episode, and that are the lessons from the case study and the study materials to help you dive deeper. Before we move on, I want to thank our partners for today's episode, and that is Cuckoo FM. People, if you loved listening to Henry Ford's story, and if you want to listen to more such stories in your own regional language, you can listen to audiobooks on Mark Zuckerberg, Elon Musk, Jack Ma, and even JRD Tata using the Cuckoo FM app. Cuckoo FM is India's leading vernacular audio learning platform, and they have got audiobooks in 6 regional languages, and you can get your hands on their 1000 hour plus content by getting the subscription at just 399 rupees. On top of that, you can get a special discount of 20% using the coupon code THINK20, which will bring down the cost further to just 319 rupees for the entire year. So if you want to learn such amazing stuff in your own regional language, download the Cuckoo FM app from the link in the description. Moving on to the lessons of the case study, there are 3 very important pointers that we need to learn from a legend like Henry Ford. Lesson number 1. Always be open to learning from industries even if they do not belong to your domain. Because those industries might have concepts that might be basic to them but could be revolutionary in your industry. In this case, it was the division of labor concept from the textile industry and the assembly line concept from the slaughterhouse that actually brought along a revolution in the automobile manufacturing. Lesson number 2. Inefficiency is a natural element that will keep creeping in regardless of what you do. But if you spot it and fix it, you can outperform your competitors by a large margin. In this case, it's the scientific principles of Mr. Taylor that shot up the productivity of the workers and generated more profits for the Ford Motor Company. And lastly, there are 2 ways to outperform your competition. Either make a product that's far superior than your competition, like the iPhone in 2008, or change the market segment altogether and go to the zero competitor zone. In this case, while all the companies were actually fighting to get hold of the richer segment of the audience, Henry Ford built a car for the bottom of the pyramid. And that turned him into one of the greatest businessmen in history and redefined automobile industry forever. That's all from my side for today, guys. Now you can have a look at the study material. And if you learned something valuable, please make sure to hit the like button in order to make YouTube Baba happy. And for more such insightful business and political case studies, please subscribe to our channel. Thank you so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.